Hello everyone, welcome to today's lecture, Cleaning and Shaping, Part 1. Coming to topic learning outcome, discuss the objectives of cleaning and shaping, describe step-by-step procedure of step back, crown down and hybrid techniques, describe briefly balance force technique, demonstrate cleaning and shaping of root canal employing step back and hybrid technique in compliance with objectives of cleaning and shaping. Clinical evidence demonstrates that root canal system can be cleaned and shaped and obturated in three dimensions with a high degree of predictability approaching 100% success. So the major objective of the root canal treatment procedure is to remove the content of the pulp space and shape the walls of the canal to receive the filling material. So for the success of the endodontic treatment, one must remove all the contents of the root canal completely, because any communication from the root canal system to the periodontal space act as a portal of entry for the bacteria to get into the root canal space, and eventually that will cause failure of the root canal treatment. An overview of endodontic therapy. So normally we do an endodontic therapy if the pulp is involved due to dental caries or due to any other trauma. So the first step will be access preparation, then followed by cleaning and shaping. So that involves working length, then you do cleaning with the help of irrigants and shaping with the help of files. So shaping can be in the form of different techniques. Some are apex to crown or some are crown down. So depends upon the technique, you clean and shape the pulpal space, then after that you are going for the obturation. Once you do the obturation, then you go ahead with the post-endodontic restoration. That is what we called as endodontic therapy as a whole. Cleaning and shaping. Cleaning refers to removal of all contents of the root canal system before and during shaping, that is organic substrates, microflora, bacterial byproducts, food debris, caries, denticles, pulp stones, previous root canal filling materials and dentinal shaving. So basically during the cleaning and shaping with the help of irrigants, you take out whatever present inside the pulpal space. So that debridement will be done with the help of irrigants. Then comes to the shaping. Shaping refers to specific cavity form with the five design objectives. So the shaping process of root canal can be classified into five phases. So the phase one, negotiating the canal, that is the patency filing. So the first step after the access preparation, you check the patency of the canal. So you will take a 6, 8 or 10 size file. If there is a curvature, you will do the pre-curving and negotiate the canal to the working length. So from the IOPA, you might have taken a pre-working length. Then after that, you will transfer into the file and you try to negotiate the canal with the smaller size file, that may be 6, 8 or 10. Then comes to the second phase, that is the coronal pre-enlargement. So the coronal pre-enlargement is important because if you are not following the coronal pre-enlargement, you may end up in certain mishaps. So that will give you a straight line access to the canal, and while you are negotiating the canal, the file will go directly to the apex. If you are not done the pre-enlargement, then the file might bind towards the walls and eventually forms the ledge. So there are other problems also occurs because of not doing the coronal pre-enlargement. You might not be able to place the file to the depth of the canal, and unnecessary cutting of the walls will also happen. So coronal pre-enlargement helps you to find the file directly go to the apex of the tooth, that is your working length. Then comes the working length measurement. Once you get that apical patency, that means your file is smoothly gone towards the apex, you will take a working length IOPA. I think you are already know about it because the working length is taken. Ingalls method, normally we use. we take the measurement from the preoperative IOPA, transfer it into the file, and you have to do the reduction of 1 mm for the distortion. Then you will place into the canal, then you will expose for the IOPA. If there is a difference in the working length, then you have to add or reduce from the file, and then again you take it one more time and you confirm the working length. So once the working length is confirmed, you are going for the shaping of the canal. That is depends upon the crown down or from apical to crown. Whichever technique you are going to use or whichever file you are going to use, according to that you will shape the canal. Then the last one is the root canal working width. Commonly we use the first or the initial file which points to the periapical region. From there we will take three more size. For example, if the 15 size is binding towards the periapical region, so that one is considered as the initial apical file which points to the canal. From there we will go for three sizes, that is 20, 25 and 30. So your master apical file will be size 30. So that is about the five phases of shaping of root canals. So first we negotiate the canal, second is coronal pre-enlargement, and third is working length measurement, fourth is shaping of canal, and last one is root canal working width. So once it is done, shaping of the canal is done. Objectives of cleaning and shaping. The primary objective in cleaning and shaping of the root canal system are remove infected soft and hard tissue, give disinfecting irrigants access to the apical canal space, create space for the delivery of the medicaments and subsequent obturation, retain the integrity of the radicular structures. So the objectives are to remove the pulp tissue, bacteria and their byproducts from the root canal space. So the procedure should be confined to the root canal space or the pulpal space, and the necrotic debris should not be forced periapically. So while doing the irrigation, you have to be really careful. You have to do a passive irrigation only. If you do an active irrigation, you are forcing the debris to go beyond the apex, and eventually patient will suffer pain. Create sufficient space for the intracanal medicament and irrigants should be created, and thereby subsequent space for the obturation. And the last one is the retaining the integrity of the radicular structures, that is by reducing the dentine removal, unnecessary cutting can be avoided. So next is Schneider's five mechanical objectives. First one is develop a continuously tapering conical form in the root canal preparation. Second, make the preparation in multiple planes, which introduces the concept of flow. Third one is make the canal narrower apically with the narrowest cross-section diameter at its terminus. Fourth one is never transport the foramen. Fifth one, keep the apical foramen as small as possible. So the five mechanical objectives are marked in the picture, you can see. So the first one, the continuously tapering conical form in the root, that is basically the funnel shape preparation which gives a continuous channel from access to the root canal. That is continuously tapering conical form. Basically when you do a cleaning and shaping, we always look for a funnel shape obturation. Then second one, make the preparation in multiple planes. So basically that is to preserve the natural curvature of the canal. Third one is the making the canal narrower apically. So this will create a resistance form to hold the guttapercha in the canal. That is the third one. Fourth one, never transport the foramen. So while cleaning the doing the cleaning and shaping, you have to make sure that there is minimal enlargement and there is no change of the apical foramen. So you are maintaining the position of the apical foramen. Fifth one, keep the apical foramen as small as possible or practical. This is to make sure that the success of the endodontic therapy is increased if you do if you keep the apical foramen as small as possible, because if you enlarge the surface area of the foramen, it might reduce the success of the endodontic therapy. So sometimes this mechanical objectives or the objectives of the cleaning and shaping has been asked as a short note. So next is biological objectives. So the biological objectives is to completely deprive the pulp space from pulp tissue, bacteria or their byproducts, dentinal debris and endotoxins. So before starting the endodontic therapy, the clinician should be planning the whole treatment as to obtain the successful treatment. So the treatment should be ensure that the particular tooth has a favorable prognosis. So before performing the cleaning and shaping, there should be a straight line access and the canal should be flared and the smooth internal wall should be obtained. So if you have a straight line access and you have a flared canal orifice or the smooth internal walls, that will help you to do the cleaning and shaping properly. And once the cleaning and shaping is done properly, you can follow the obturation and the seal the pulp chamber or the pulp space completely. Once the obturation is done, you should make sure that the postendodontic restoration is done to prevent the micro leakage into the canals. So thereby you can get a good outcome from the treatment. So basically the biological objective is to make sure the cleaning and shaping done properly with the mechanical as well as the biological objectives. So the ultimate aim is to make sure the remnants, that is the pulp tissue or the bacterial byproducts or the dentinal debris or endotoxins, should be removed from the canal with the help of irrigants and thereby placing the intra canal medicament and followed by the obturation, and thereby you get the three-dimensional obturation. So next is instrument motions. The first one is reaming. It is a repeated clockwise rotation of the instrument which will shape the canal walls and give a cross-sectional preparation approximately round. So the term ream indicates clockwise or a right-hand rotation of an instrument. So the cutting edge of all endodontic files and reamers are spiral. So this configuration causes them to slide into the canal as the edge rotates to the right. So as they rotate and slides into the canal, more and more of the length of the instrument engages the canal, that is basically the dentine. And if the instrument over inserts and bends, that further rotation will cause separation. So while doing the reaming action, you have to make sure that you should not give lot of power and it should not be over inserted. If you are over inserting and if it bends, and the further rotation will cause separation. So make sure that reaming is an action which indicates clockwise, that is the right-handed rotation of an instrument. So the second one is filing. It is the push-pull action without rotation, which has a great efficiency with the files than reamers. So basically it indicates a push-pull action. In the picture you can see the number one down and the second one up. So basically it indicates the push-pull action with the instrument. So the inward passage of the K-type file, that means when you push a K file into the canal, so if your working loads, if you work with a good working load, it might damage the canal walls. So even when the slightest curvature is encountered. So basically what happens with the push-pull action, that filing motion, is that when you try to put the file inside the canal, the up and down motion, if you are not following the coronal reference point properly, it might damage the canal walls. So it can cut easily, at the same time it can damage the canal wall very quickly. So basically if there is a curvature, if you are not following the coronal reference point, you are just giving a load and it goes beyond the apex or sometimes it might create a ledge also. So you have to be really careful when you're using the push-pull action. Next is watch winding motion, a gentle right and left rocking motion which causes the instrument to cut while a light inward pressure keeps the file engaged and progressing towards the apex. So basically watch winding motion is the back and forth oscillation, that is a 30 to 60 degree you move to your right and left. So basically when you move to your right, it engages the dentine, and when you move towards the left, it is disengaging the dentine, or it just cuts and remove the dentine from the flutes. So that right and left motion keeps it in a loosely form inside the canal, so that separation or the binding of the walls are less. So this is the much common method which you use for negotiating the canal. So it's like a right and left turn you just giving into the canal. So at the same time it engages, and when you take it to the left, it disengages the dentine. So this is kind of safer to use inside the canal to avoid any separation. So next is balance force technique. So this technique involves oscillation of the instrument right and left with different degrees in both directions. So when the file engages with the apical pressure, 1/4 turn was given in a clockwise direction, that is about 90 degree. Then with a small apical pressure, 3/4 turn counterclockwise is given. So that is about 180 to 270 degree. You can see in the picture numbered as 2. So if it is done properly, at this time you will hear a click when the instrument is cutting dentine. So you have to repeat this sequence 2 or 3 times to reach the working length. And once it reaches that working length, you have to make sure you give a clockwise direction, complete clockwise direction, and take it out completely so that debris comes along with the file. So this technique is one of the most efficient technique to cut the dentine, but care should be given to prevent the excessive cutting. So the first turn is about 90 degree to the right, then you give a counterclockwise, that is about 3/4, then you have to make sure give a small apical pressure, take it to the full working length 2 or 3 times. Then once it is reached, you have to give a complete clockwise direction rotation and take out the file with the debris. Circumferential filing. So the instrument is first moved towards the buccal side, then reinserted and removed slightly mesially. This continues around the preparation to the lingual aspect and then to the distal until all the dentinal walls have received rasping. So basically in the picture you can see all directions, you can see the arrow mark. So basically the circumferential filing, as the name itself, you have to make sure all the surface of the canal is filed properly. So insert the file in one direction and take it along all the four directions, buccal, lingual, mesial and distal. So you will get a circumferential filed tooth. Basically all the surfaces of the canals are cleaned properly. So next is basic principles of canal instrumentation. So there should be a straight line access to the root canal system. So once you have made the access opening, you have to make sure the internal dentinal walls are smoothened, and if there is any dentinal overlying over the orifice, it has to be removed so that you will get a straight line access. So if you have a straight line access, your cleaning and shaping is going to be really good and you can work effectively. Then second is copious irrigation should be done in between the instrumentation. So irrigation means you have to make sure once the file is taken out from the canal, you have to make sure the canal is irrigated. And you have to do it in such a way that it should not be active. It should be in a passive method. So that is inside, outside, like that. So you make sure that it is passively irrigated. Third is prepared canal should retain its form and shape. So basically you have to follow the mechanical objectives. Then comes the exploration of the orifice should be done with the smaller size file to gauge the canal size and configuration. So most of the students I have noticed once they do the access, they directly place the try to take the file and place into the canal. So make sure you have a straight line access. Once you have straight line access, you take your smaller size file. So depends upon the canal, you take 6, 8 or 10. Then you try to explore the canal. So try to check the patency of the canal. So once the canal enlargement should be done using instruments in a sequential order. So you cannot skip instruments in between. So you have to follow the number 15, 20, 25. Like that you have to follow. If you skip the order, that will eventually form ledges or any obstruction inside the canal. And you have to frequently inspect the flutes of the instrument. So while you are performing the treatment, you find some stress onto the file, you have to take it out and see whether you have the right length. So for example, if you are working inside the canal, you find it a bit of difficulty, you take out the file and measure it whether my file size is there or not. So for that you have to know which size file you are using and how much was your working length. So you have to measure and check, yeah, my working length is still there. So that means you can make sure that there is no separation happen. Then you have to make sure that there is no debris present onto the flute. So you have to clean the flutes regularly and never force the instrument into the canal. So if you are not able to place the canal into the deepest portion, then you make sure you go back to the smaller size file and try to negotiate and keep it. Then you slowly enlarge it. Recapitulation is regularly done to loosen debris. Again, recapitulation is important and most of the students doesn't know about it. Don't worry, the next slide is about recapitulation. So you have to make sure that the instrument, smaller size instrument, is used after each irrigation. This is to make sure that there is no debris placed or packed towards the apex. So later that will create an apical plug and will create the obstruction for the canal. Then over preparation and too aggressive over enlargement of the curved canal should be avoided. So while cutting the curved canals, you have to make sure that you have given that curvature filing. Pre-curving should be done and then you have to take it. And don't use bigger size files towards the curvature. That will straighten up the curve. Then overusing of larger files must be avoided as it may result in further enlargement of access opening and it may cause the unnecessary removal of dentine and thereby you are not preserving the integrity of the tooth. So make sure you follow these principles, then you work. Clear? So recapitulation. So it is the re-instrumentation with a smaller instrument following each irrigation step. Why is it done? Use of a smaller size instrument to remove debris produced during instrumentation prevents pushing debris beyond the apex and apical plug formation. So for example, if you are doing the cleaning and shaping and you have reached your master apical file, that is for example 25. So you have, after irrigation, you have to go to the smaller size file 15, then make sure that you have gone to the full working length. Then after each files, for example 30, irrigate and then go back to the smaller size file 35, go back to the smaller size file. So this makes sure that there is no apical plug formation, you are not pushing any debris towards the apex, thereby you can prevent the apical plug formation and there won't be any blockage of canal. Sometimes the students come and say that I have difficulty going towards the apex of the root. So basically what we have to do is that you have to take a smaller size file, put one drop of sodium hypochlorite, then try to negotiate the canal. Because previous appointment you might have plugged the debris towards the apex, so that act as a barrier for preventing the file to reach to the apex. So that is all about today's lecture. In the next lecture, we will go for the different techniques for the preparation. I hope you all understood. If you have any doubts, please inform or let me know. Thank you.